Salve galera, tudo bem com vocês? Estamos aqui com o Mark do Electric Underground, o Paulo, PV e Shmup Junkie. E hoje é a nossa primeira podcast feito em português, digo em inglês. Então, se você tiver a oportunidade, liga a legenda para você poder entender o que a gente está falando, ou então se vira nos 30 e ouve em inglês aí. Beleza? Eu vou passar para inglês então e espero que a sua legenda já esteja acionada. Okay, guys, English now.
English
Welcome,
mode
guys.
activate.
English
Hey.
mode activate. Well, welcome. This is the first our first attempt to do like a podcast in English, and I think we have something pretty much wrapped up here that could work. So, I don't think none of you guys require introductions here in my channel. You're pretty much known from the Brazilian community, so I only have
reputations precede us.
Yeah.
In a good way.
I feel better afterwards.
Thank you. Thank you for joining. Thank you for allocating some time into in our busy lives to be here and participating on the podcast. And what I plan for today is a little bit of a I want to do something like the, you know, the Academy Awards, like the Oscar Awards. So I was thinking about picking up a more methodic shmup as a shmup of course, like the 2022 choices, but you don't have to, doesn't need to be like exclusively from 2022. If it's from 2022, even better. But I'd like to know from you guys, what do you think it's the, what would be your choice of methodic shmup from 2022? A more modern bullet hell, an unexpected novelty, something you find interesting, but still a shmup, a running gun or a rail shooter, something going out of the shmup spectrum, but still a shmup, shmup-like. Some people hate me when I say rail shooters are shmups, but anyway, I don't care.
We have a whole video about that, so just post that video.
Yeah, no, people, just send you know, people love to, you know, compartmentalize things. I don't deal with this very well. Anyway, of course, your shmup of the year, your picks, and a stay away slash avoid like the plague, like the shmup or the game or anything you say, don't play it, or I don't recommend, I don't like it, I played and I regret, or I refund, I ask for a refund or something, anything. So, who wants to start?
Shmup Junkie wants to start.
Oh, I guess so. I guess Mark says I want to start, so I'll start.
Yeah.
Are we
democracy.
With,
democracy is a bitch.
I learned that in school.
We're starting
I learned that
with
trick
modern,
in school.
Right?
Yeah. What would be your methodic pick?
That's a tough one. I mean, there's a few that came out this year that have been really good. And in my mind, it's a choice between Androdunos 2, which I believe came out this year, right, in 22.
Yes, it did.
And Softstar, which was a vertical version. They're both fantastic. It's almost kind of hard to make a choice because they're such different games, and it has more to do with your personal preference than anything else. I think longevity-wise, if I had to pick between the two, I would go with Softstar. Just simply because I love vertical shooters. I love anything that's in the style of like older compile games. And that has so much content and so many ships that, you know, Androdunos 2 is an awesome game. I loved it. But there's only so many times I can kind of play it over and over again. That's, you know, it's kind of a very traditional type of game. It was a great time, great music. But now that I've beaten it, you know, a few times, it's kind of like, okay, I'll come back to it eventually when I'm feeling the craving. But Softstar just has so much to keep coming back to. Like I've, even though I've played it, like I need to come back to it to play it more and do more with it and try other ships and try other modes. You know, there's, it's just like, it's one of those games that came out of nowhere. We knew it was, not everybody knew it was coming. It was unexpected and it came out, you know, a lot better than I think anybody was expecting, except for the developers. I'm sure they knew.
All right.
And the beta testers.
Who want to be the second, Paulo?
I can be the second one. Fine. So for me, I liked for Softstar a lot, but I think that the best methodic shooter for me would be Drainus, because I seem to have an awesome time playing it. It's a fun game from the start. You have like a cinematic presentation. Everything that happens on the background has some meaning to the plot. So it's hard to have a shmup that you get so immersed into the story through the backgrounds and what the characters say. It's still a cheesy plot in the end, but it works really well. And the way they implement like the two loops was very fun, because I have to play the game twice, but they kind of explain and how why the difficulty ramps up. So it's a very creative way that they handle the game. It's a bit on the easy side, of course. So I think that for people that are used to cave games, they'll say, oh, I can beat that with a hand on my back, because it's not a hard game at all. But it's something that you have to play to at least enjoy what they did in terms of presentation, visuals, music. So it's a very good package. So that was my surprise. I wasn't surprised so much by Softstar, because I had beta tested it before, so I knew what we were getting into. But yeah, it's still like a very solid game. I think that you should play both of them. But my personal choice for this one would be for Drainus.
All righty. Well, I would actually agree with Shmup Junkie and choose Softstar. But in order to not repeat myself, I'll go ahead and give my number two pick, because I think he said it exactly. I would say the same thing. Just play it back. That's why I would choose Softstar. Also, Softstar, to mention, is a little bit more updated, I think, a little bit than even Drainius is, or than Androdunos 2, as far as the scoring system. It has like some teleport mechanics. It's trying some new stuff while also being very faithful to the Toplan style, which I really appreciate. But I'm going to give my number two pick, because we haven't talked about it, which is a game that came out of absolutely nowhere. I only know about it because I worked on the list on my channel, which is this game called Moon Dancer. This is a really cool shmup. I think Shmup Junkie would really like it. It reminds me a lot of a PC Engine Rekka type shmup. What do you call it? Yeah, I'm trying to think of the other ones like it. Spriggan, kind of like that. And it also definitely has some Rayforce influence as well, because basically the way it works is you only have one shot button, and things come in from the bottom, and you lock onto them, and then you release it to fire on them. But it's a much quicker pace than Rayforce is. It's a little bit more accessible. It's a lot more simple as well. But really well done. Nice, easy difficulty in normal mode, but there's also higher difficulties. I thought it was a fantastic game. I think if it had a little bit more in the presentation side, it had a little bit more with the mechanics, I think it could have been a real surprise winner for this category. But I think number two slot for that one, if you haven't checked it out, was really cool.
Yeah, you know, it's crazy that Terraren comes out with so many games so often. It's like he did Raging Blasters. The next year he did Moon Dancer, which is what you're talking about. And he already literally released a third game called Terraflame. It just came out like in December, which is Thunder Force style. It's more of a side scroller. But like, he's just got gameplay mechanics down. Like, he's a workhorse. Like, he doesn't spend a ton of time, like you said, on the presentation of things. You know, the graphics are simple. But he's got a good guy doing the music, and he's punching him out. Like, and every game is just solid. Like, he's got it down now. He knows how to make good playing games.
Yeah, so that one definitely y'all should check out.
Yeah, it's very Thunder Force inspired. It's pretty much like it's, and even the music sounds like something from Thunder Force. I really like it. Well, anyway, I think it's my turn. I think my pick is Softstar, because I participated on the whole development in terms of giving ideas, giving playing the game as a beta tester, and it was fun to participate, you know. So even if I wasn't one of the devs, like I have nothing to do with Banana Bytes, like I was just like helping them to advertise the game and of course play and test it. I don't know, it grew up on me, you know, when I was like ready to get back to the game and play it more like every now and then. And this is pretty rare, like if you consider the amount of games we can play, like we have available to play, like it, and when you miss something, you say, I think I want to play Softstar. This is pretty rare. And but I agree with the other picks. I guess Under Dunas 2 is pretty good as well. I would say it's probably close to a draw. And I also agree that Softstar tried lots of new stuff, like tried to the teleport, tried to many ships has like crazy mechanics. Mm-hmm. Like they are pretty hard they require some time for you to, you have to spend some time playing it and until you wrap your head around it and say, okay, now I understand how the ship works. So yeah, they're probably not the most, it's probably Softstar is not the most traditional game, but I think it deserves this spot on my list.
Cool.
Okay. And okay, the second one, second category is Bullet Hell. I think we had a lot of Bullet Hells, huh?
I didn't feel like we had too many this year. We had some good ones, but some years we get a whole pile of them. I think this year was a little bit more even across the board. Maybe that's just me, though.
I guess
my pick would be so easy. Like I would, I mean, I don't have to go first, but like I've as soon as he's mentioned Bullet Hell, I mean, I think a lot of us will probably have the same pick for the number one for new games that came out. And Mark already knows what I'm going to say because Mark's probably going to say the same thing.
No. And that's everyone's going to say the same thing.
Everything's going to say Gunvane, right? Because
The
game's awesome. I mean, it's as traditional Bullet Hell as it gets. Hardcore Bullet Hell, aggressive Bullet Hell, Ketsui style Bullet Hell. And it's just, I mean, Boghog did an awesome job with it. We all know he's a great developer when it comes to Bullet Hell gameplay and he knows what he's doing. And he took his time. And I think NG Dev Team is lucky that they had him doing the programming on that game because it's exceptional. That's easily my number one pick for Bullet
Hell. Definitely Boghog's brainchild. Absolutely. The man behind it. Absolutely. Yeah, I would agree for sure. Gunvane would be my number one pick. Not to dwell on it too long, but yeah, I think Gunvane is a great example of, you know, the whole Euro shmup thing where people say, you know, Euro shmups and the issues with Euro shmups, myself being one of those people. Gunvane is one of those shmups that's out to change that perception because it is from Europe, but you wouldn't it does not fall into any of those pitfalls. Mm-hmm. And it's starting to really creep up.
It plays like a cave game.
Absolutely. It's really to creeping up on that quality that we haven't seen in quite a bit of time. You know, every now and again we get indie releases like that, like Zero Ranger and Blue Revolver, but it's you know, it's like a special type of thing when these types of games come around. So I've been having a ton of fun with it. I'm definitely going to cover it more when the console ports come out. So I thought might as well give my second pick because that way we're kind of evening this spread a little bit. So one game that kept coming up all year long, people just messaged me all year long. Hey, are you going to play Like Dreamer? What about Like Dreamer? Have you seen Like Dreamer? What are your thoughts on Like Dreamer? And I was like, oh, I'll get to that eventually. So just before doing my video, I sat down and I got Like Dreamer and I played it. I'm like, okay, I get why everyone's messaging me about this game. It is really good. It's like almost the perfect blend of Toho and Cave. It's almost like the exact cross point between them where it has a really Toho style presentation, but it has actual levels and actual patterns in the levels and things like that. It's not just all boss fights. Mm-hmm. And then the boss fights kind of have a bit more of a Cave Toho crossover vibe to it. It's really good game. So that one is also really up there for the Bullet Hell fans. And I know the Toho fans are really digging it.
Yeah, my pick would be Gunvane as well for the same reasons. And I have something interesting that I found interesting when I watched the M2 presentation. Did you guys think that someone in M2 was playing Gunvane? Because one of the ships played pretty much the same, like the red ship from Gunvane.
Oh, I haven't seen that yet. I didn't watch their stream other than.
Are you talking about for Alesta Branch?
Yeah, the Alesta Branch. One of the ships has exactly the same cone mechanic.
I think they both of those are pulling from a similar source, which is Crimson Clover.
Yeah.
But the cone is different, right? Yeah. Gunvane's cone is different than Crimson Clover's sort of field.
Yeah.
That is crazy.
I think I saw this cone somewhere, you know, when I saw that. Well,
originally when I see the cone, I mean, that first game I think of back is like Sokyu Gurentai. That's like, if you go back with, you know, Rising, mm-hmm. and, you know, it's not exactly the same, but, you know, especially some of the ships and you can adjust like the width and the, mm-hmm. and the reach of the cone, and you know, as the way it's a little bit more Rayforce style, but just the idea of having a cone kind of came from that game, at least in my mind. That's the first time I remember seeing something
what
like.
I thought it was remind me of Gunvane because of the cone and the, you know, the reticle around the ship. Mm-hmm. Was like, but I found a pretty interesting choice of design, and I think like Boghold would probably be flattered if someone comes up with a ship similar to Gunvane in Elastic.
No, but I definitely got it. After this, I got to look at it.
Yeah,
see. That'd be really interesting.
I always thought Type C though was like such an awesome, fun ship to play in, like because it didn't have that. You know, like B was almost like, what's the point of having a range because it's so long? It's like you're just basically just destroying everything. Mm-hmm. It's weaker. Where, you know, Type A was fun to play with. Type C is super fun to play with.
No, Type C is my first pick always.
I told Boghog Type C is going to be the most popular because it's that bombing style ship. Everyone's going to love that.
I think one thing maybe the devs have to understand is when you're playing a shmup, you like destroying things, and destroying things is fun, you know? So you have like a big bomb to like drop anything and wrap up half of the screen is fantastic. Like it's so satisfying.
Should be satisfying. You have the keyword there.
And I have a problem with shmups when you don't, you know, you don't get it. Like you shoot, you collect power ups, you do everything, and you don't get strong, and it's so meh. Mm, you know.
Yeah.
I call
like
it the
shmups that have really minimal death animations. Like one shmup I really enjoyed, but this was a real issue with it, was Space Moth, because they kind of fixed it a little bit in Lunar Edition. But the original Space Moth, when that came out, they just kind of went into a little splat, and that was it. And I was like, oh man, they need to like blow up or something.
You erase the enemy. You don't destroy. Yeah, yeah. You don't blow the enemy.
Yeah.
This is probably very reminiscent of the first Hero Shmups, I guess. Most of them were like just removing the sprites instead of adding an explosion or something.
Yeah.
I call this the Rick Sember curse. Like if you play Rick Sember, you never get strong.
Yeah, there's a lot of shmups like that as
you get your ass kicked from the first second to the last one, and you never get strong. So
Ray Zambert was one of those games that could have been awesome, but it's just not.
I think someone there thought like, how can I make this game be so hard, annoying, and not fun? And they just managed.
They're just like, the game is beautiful.
No, don't get me wrong.
They're not trying to make it annoying, but they're trying to make it harder. But they don't forget they're not making it harder at the when you are powered up. They make it harder when people just died.
No,
just like
the Iron Blade. They just don't give you the tools. They just don't give you the tools.
The stage design is there. The gameplay mechanics are there. The graphics are great. The music is awesome. Like everything's there. But then they make your ship so pitiful. That it's just like a chore just to kill anything and get through anything, and you just feel weak the entire time, and it just destroys you from start to finish.
I think they just makes the game fired. Fun. I think they just fired the game design that had the fun ideas like right before the game was released, and nobody cared. I think they're just gonna play there. They're gonna play this anyway. Like that's fine.
Until it's not.
Anyway,
just to wrap this up, so I will also say Gunvane for the best bullet hell. So I will avoid repeating everyone else so that we could just move ahead.
I just would like to say NG Dev never sponsored this video, okay? So be aware. No, they didn't.
No, they did not.
Okay. But anyway, thanks Boghog for the awesome game you presented us. Okay. The third pick will be the unexpected / novelty, something that you play that you just wasn't expecting, or you find it fun and or it's way too different from what you were your taste, but you end up liking it. And who was to be the first?
I can start. So the one that was a surprise for me was quite recently when we did the video for Gyroblade. So the dev for that small game for the Nintendo Switch was already on Steam, but was released this year on the Switch. It was a $5 game, so shouldn't be that great anyways, I'll just let it try. And the game was fun. It has some fundamental design problems in some areas, like you have to shoot enemies at least twice or thrice to kill some of them when you are in your minimum power. When you power up, it's an okay game. But it was really something that I wasn't expecting for a one-man army. So it was just one guy doing that game in Japan. It was pretty well balanced. It reminisces me a lot of Tiger Healy and Flying Shark. So the guy really was looking to that Toa plan style of game. So it was completely unexpected. I didn't even know that the game existed before getting that key code to try it out. So Felipe even joked to me that it was the longest 10 minutes video someone did for a $5 game, something like that. But it was a game that surprised me. It was something that was kind of, okay, this is fun to play, and it's from just one guy that did that in his basement in Tokyo, something like that.
Yeah, let me tell you a fun story about this game. I got a key, and I had no time to make a review. And then I invite Paulo and said, Paulo, do you want to make the review? He said, nah, I don't think so. And now he's saying that he enjoyed the game. So that's it.
Yeah. And the funny thing is that Felipe got the key, and I got the key from the publisher. So they contact me and say, hey, we have the key for this game. Don't try. I said, okay. So two people asked me to do the same game. Let's try it. And okay, it was fun.
Yeah. Okay, who wants to be the next?
Next.
I'll go next. So I'm going to cheat because I'm going to bring in a genre that's not a shmup, but I don't care because I'm being a bad boy. So a game that came out
This is my channel. You go as you want.
Okay.
Ask for permission. Go for it.
Okay. It's an arcade game, so I think it's close enough. Which is, so in the wake of Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, Shredder's Revenge, hold it. I was like, you know, my channel's just getting, everyone's yelling at me because I didn't really like that game very much. It's not the greatest beat 'em up of all time, it turns out.
They don't like Shredder's Revenge? Really?
I don't like it. But on the same day that bad boy came out, another beat 'em up came out that no one talked about, which is called Final Vendetta.
Oh, and so that's what.
I got Final Vendetta purely as like a palate cleanser from Shredder's Revenge, and I thought, oh, it'd be interesting to kind of play it just to give myself a break from that game. And I played it and I was like, oh my god, this game is actually super fun. So my surprise pick that I think is actually really underrated and really cool is for this year is definitely Final Vendetta. That I mania cleared all three characters. That's how fun it was. I beat it on the hardest difficulty with each character. I just kept streaming it and I was like, I'm getting behind on my schedule, but I had so much fun with that game. So that would be my pick, Final Vendetta.
All right.
For me, I don't think anyone will have picked this, actually. And it's a game that I've played before. And I got an early demo of it, and I even showed it in a video a long time ago. And I didn't know how the final product would come out, because I didn't get to play enough of it. But it finally came out this year, and it's a twin-stick shmup. It's not a twin-stick shooter. It's an actual shmup twin-stick called Never Awake. And I know some of you guys have seen it before. And that game is really cool. It's came out even better than I expected it would. It's got solid mechanics all the way around. What's great about it is that it's has so much variety. I mean, initially you notice the game because the graphics are incredible. Like you look at the art design, you're like, oh my God, what is this? I have to see it. And it turns out to be a shmup. And originally the concept didn't seem like something I would like, which is kind of like loop-based, where every level has all these different stages to it. So there's like different worlds. It's almost like Mario, you know, you have like this themed world and this themed world and this themed world. There's several of them. And it consists of all these sub stages that are loops, and you have to be able to finish those loops. They only last like about a minute. So they're really fast. And the idea is that you have to score high enough and kill enough to kind of progress to the next world, You have to play it well enough. So each little subsection feels like its own little mini puzzle, where, you know, you're playing through this twin stick shooter that looks really good and sounds good. And as you progress through the game, you upgrade your character. So it has that whole feature set of like increasing all your weapons and improving and kind of customizing. All the different stages are different and the puzzles are different. So you're constantly changing up what your loadout is for that particular level. So you can try it in different ways and play through it again. And there's kind of a real sense of progression to it because you want to see what the next world and what the next what everything looks like, A, because the graphics are great, and B, because the puzzles are really fun. And it's almost like you want to keep doing better and better and better at it. to kind of progress. So there's a lot of in the game that pulls you in, and I haven't had enough time to actually finish it yet. I've only gotten through like a few worlds. But if anyone's never heard of it or seen it, I'd highly recommend like checking out Neverawake, because it's really, really well done. And it surprised me like how good of a game it is. And I'm hoping it does well just because visually it's so stunning that it'll attract attention, you know, for anyone who wants to play that kind of game.
Yeah, I remember seeing the trailer. The trailer is amazing.
I almost covered it, but I was like pressed for time. And I was like, well, yeah. It's a twin stick, so I don't have to cover it, right?
I like it.
But in all fairness, it's absolutely 100% a shmup. It's auto-scrolling. It plays like a shmup. It fulfills all the requirements. It's not like an overhead, you know, running gun types twin stick shooter. It's a straight up twin stick shmup. Just the way you control it's a little bit different.
I got a little bit traumatized because of Forgotten Worlds. I don't know, man. I think I'm genetically incapable of playing that game. But anyway, you know, it doesn't work well in my brain. But apart from that, like, I'll give it a try when it comes out. Oh, it's out already, right?
Yeah.
Oh, nice.
Forgotten Worlds. That sounds familiar. What is that?
It's an old classic game. It's a game from Capcom.
Oh,
Capcom, man.
Yeah, the problem with Forgotten Worlds is that it was designed to play with a rotary. So in
the arcade,
it had a rotary, and if you play it that way, then it's different. But now when you're playing at home, you have to adapt to like analog sticks or a controller. And
interesting.
It doesn't feel the same. So,
but the problem, I think the game is like all over the place. You know, nothing in the game seems to make sense. Like if you see the game like in a magazine, you think it's like a counter game. But then you're going to play, the guys are flying and nothing makes... Anyway, it's beautiful. It's a beautiful game. And in the end, I think like it has a huge fan base, but I never managed to, you know, make my brain work in order to play it. But anyway, this is just me. All right, Paulo or me?
You rock, paper, scissors.
Oh, it's me. No, I think it's me. we didn't okay, I'll say mine. The game that I wasn't expecting to like and I ended up liking a lot was Draenus, or Draenus. How do you say
Draenus?
I don't know, man.
You can drain whatever you want, man.
You know, my inside Bart Simpson, my first degree, that my first grader doesn't allow me to say this game and not think about a way of, you know, twisting the name and making a bad joke. But anyway,
yeah, someone on the localization team should have said, stop. Yeah. boys we need to rethink the vowels in this title here.
Yeah, I was thinking about like someone just released and never thought the kind of jokes are gonna make on this.
Or maybe that was intentional. So yeah, let's get some free publicity because the internet will be on fire over this title.
I don't think so. But anyway, I when I first saw Draenus, I said, okay, this game looks beautiful. I don't know how it's gonna play, but anyway, I took my chances and I start playing it. And even if it doesn't make sense in many ways for me, I like it. Like it doesn't, I don't like the shops. I don't like the Euro Shmup style. I don't like this low pace, but I like the game. I don't know how to explain. It just makes sense. Like,
that's some solid level design. That's for sure.
Yeah.
I think that's what kind of separates it from a lot of Euro Shmuppy type games is that even though it has a lot of Euro shmuppy type systems, like it never falls quite into that. Like there's a shop system, but everything's pretty balanced and well powered, so you're not like underpowered all the time. And it has these slow stages, but they're pretty dense and full of stuff to do. Yeah. So
there's a lot of content in there. Like it's not like a shallow experience. Like you feel that like there's something in it for me, and that's what I like it in it.
Yeah, and I feel like that the ideas for the shops that, okay, you can purchase weapons, but you don't lose them. You can equip them like you get like the power caps from Graves, and you can actually improve your ship over time, but you set up how you want the ship to be. So that's a step ahead of whatever any Hiroshima did before.
I think what Draenus definitely taught me is don't judge a game by the cover. And second, you can make a very fun game, and especially a very fun shmup, if even if you distance the game from the arcade experience. Like, this definitely plays and feels like an, I would say, an old Amiga game. Not sure if you guys grew up playing the Amiga, but it feels for me like an Amiga game, but a good one, because the shmups on Amiga sucks. Like, it's very hard to find a good shmup in the Amiga. Like, I tried. I grew up playing Paolo, probably.
There are so many, and most of them are just crap.
They are, I don't know, the idea, the concept of level design back in Europe and back in the day, and it's just not what we expect to play. So we end up being very hard to play nowadays. And when I first saw it, I said, man, this looks like an Amiga game, but beautiful, but like with a good art direction. It's not true. The game is good.
Yeah, the graphics are really impressive, especially for an indie release.
Actually, to be honest, like, I think they just did like a very good, the game is very polished. That's what I like it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Paulo said the Gyro Blade. Let's see the next one. Okay. The running gun or rail shmup, or something that's tier shmup but going outside the spectrum, if you find something, of course.
Is it for something new that released this year, or just in general?
And play as year? You wish. If you just manage to get to play it on 2022, it's fine.
Well, we do have to ask the panel real quick. Did any new run and guns come out this year that were like good?
Yeah.
Because I'm trying to think of one. I can't think of one, but I'm...
Yeah, if you just Blazing Chrome,
Blazing Chrome's been around for a while.
Yeah, exactly. That's what they say. The great, the one that had played quite some time ago.
Doesn't matter if it's not from 2022, but you just played it recently. It's fine.
Yeah,
I have two answers. If you all want me to go,
I want both.
One's a fun sort of joke answer, and then I'll give you the real answer. So the joke answer is, I realized this year that Guange is a gallery shooter. I realized that. I was like, oh my gosh, this game's a gallery shooter. Because I was playing it, and I was playing and I was flying the Shiki around. I'm like, why do I love this game so much? And then it like clicked in my head. This is not just a regular shmup. It's a gallery shooter, because the way the Shiki works, it's like a cursor. It just all clicked in my head. So I discovered that Guange is a gallery shooter this year. And then my real answer for run and gun, this counts because I found it this year, because I don't think anything came out this year.
That's
I came across
point.
It this year's, which is Wild Arms Reloaded, and I really wanted to make a video on it, but I just didn't have time. That game is fun as hell.
Yeah.
So if y'all haven't seen Wild Arms Reloaded, it's an awesome gallery shooter. It reminds me so much of Sin and Punishment. It's like almost as good as Sin and Punishment. So that one is definitely my recommendation if you've never seen it before.
It's fun because, like, I remember, Paulo probably knows what I'm talking about, but back in Brazil in the 90s, I remember, like, now Wild Guns is a kind of a cult game. Like, people like it, but people there's like a lot of people saying, wow, Wild Guns, this game is amazing. But I remember back in the day, nobody cared about this game. Mm-hmm. I remember on the Blockbusters in Brazil, like, we had, like, tons of Wild Guns like getting dust in the shelves, and nobody cared about it. Like, you could trade this game for like a burger and a Coke, because nobody cared. Like,
but that game at least had some following back in the day, just like Sonic Wings, because you could play like multiplayer, you could play two people. And in Brazil, something that was funny is that people rented video games by the hour to play.
Yeah.
So we went to the, let's say, to some Blockbuster style place you could rent video games, and could rent a Super Nintendo, a Genesis, or a 3DO to play by the hour. And because people want to be really as cheap, they would split the hour in two. So they would go with the money for 1 hour each, they would play 2 hours, and you would get those games you can play like two people co-op or competitively at the same time. So that's why
wild.
Wild Guns, Sonic Wings, and Top Gear, some games that are well loved in Brazil. Nobody say, okay, why who play Top Gear? Yeah, in Brazil people play that a lot.
Yeah.
Because you can play two people at the same time.
Just to clarify for the international viewers, you rent the game but you don't take it home. Like there was a room with lots of TVs and SNES and Mega Drives and Neo Geos and whatever, and you just rent it and play by hour in there.
That's wild. I'm sure Nintendo was thrilled with that idea, by the way. I'm sure they loved that.
Nintendo didn't even know we existed back then.
No, don't say this word here. They're gonna block us. They're gonna drop the video.
Nintendo's suing Blockbuster. Meanwhile, in Brazil, they're renting out Super Nintendo.
All righty.
Awesome. Right. I guess in my case, it's a game that I should have played a long time ago, and for some reason, it's the kind of game I would normally play, and I just finally showed it in my recent Run and Guns video. Because it's a modern game, it released a few years ago. It's relatively new, and it's available for all consoles and Steam, but I wasn't a big Steam player when it originally came out back then, and I just kind of missed it and didn't think about it. And honestly, I can't believe I didn't. And that was Super Cyborg.
Oh yeah,
I don't know if you guys have seen or played Super
Cyborg. I saw it in your video.
It's basically a Contra clone. It's a Super Contra clone. It plays just like it, except it's much, much harder. But what's interesting is when I showed that in the video, I don't know how many copies of that thing I sold, but I had so many comments like, oh my God, where can I play this game? Where can I play this game? You know, where's it? Or they actually paid attention and they saw on the side of my video that you could choose all the consoles it's already on, like the entire thing. And they actually just went and bought it. And they were like, I can't believe it was only $3. Like, or it was only $2 on, you know, PS4 eShop. So it's super That's cheap. Crazy. It's like $2 or $3 right now. And it should have sold so much better, because aside from it being too hard, I guess you would say for most people, it's a phenomenal game. Like if you're willing to put up with it and you like hard Contra games and you learn it, Super Cyborg is awesome. Like everything about it is just wonderful. Like the way it controls, the music, the art style is awesome. As long as you can handle the difficulty curve, because even on easy, it's not easy, it's hard. Nice. It starts easy is hard, and then normal is like really hard, and it goes up from there. But
easy hard, honestly, Nintendo hard.
But honestly, easy mode is pretty much your typical like Nintendo hard level, all the way up until the last level, which really kind of ramps up. But the first time I played it, I started on easy mode, and I had no problem like eventually getting all the way to the final stage within like, you know, an hour or two, like just learning each level over and over again until you can get through it. So in any case, that was my run and gun surprise. Is like, I should have played this game years ago and I didn't. And I'm glad I did.
I was just doing a little bit of research while you're speaking. It has like no reviews anywhere.
Yeah.
It's like,
no. Yeah.
It's like it's secret release. It might as well have come out when Shmup Junkie talked about it on his channel.
The music was done by Darkman 007. And so the music in the game is freaking awesome. You know, like everyone sees the graphics, like this game looks great, this game sounds great, it plays just like Super Contra. You would think everybody would be all over it.
Isn't that crazy how that works with retro arcade games? Like they either get all the love and they're the best thing ever, or they don't exist. That's like
they're polar opposites.
What really sucks is that I looked back at like old reviews. I try to like, didn't this game get reviewed? Like how was it? And all the reviews I kept coming across kept saying, this game is too hard. They all just complained that it was too hard, so they couldn't play it. So it's like, it's basically, you know, if you want to play Contra, it's just like Contra, but it's really, really hard. You know, and that turns a lot of people off because they're like, oh,
unless you have a really good PR team, then it works. That's what I'm saying. Yeah. Like if that game had a good PR team and it was, you know, like Cuphead or whatever, it would have been, oh, this is the best thing ever. But if it doesn't have a good PR team, it just does not exist. The game just is in the void of lostness.
You know that
when that happens.
I managed to get a Steam Deck recently, and I said I'm finally playing Steam games as a video game, because like it's very hard for me to like I'm an IT worker, so I work in front of my computer all day long. So it's very hard for me to sit in front of my computer and play games with this, you know, change this mindset that, oh, now I'm gonna play games here. No, this is my work. So I'm finally playing the Steam games as a console. And I started researching like shmups in the Steam library, and this exactly what you mentioned, like you see lots of shmups with zero reviews and you have no idea if they're good or not, because they sometimes cost like $3, $5, but nobody talk about them. So I think you have to pick your take your chances and buy them, because like anyway. But okay, yeah, so I guess... yeah, Paulo, go ahead. Sorry.
Okay, so I guess this is my turn then. So for me, it's not exactly a run and gun by definition, but it's definitely playing like a run and gun game, but inside the Metroidvania framework, which is Iconoclast. It's not new game, it's out for quite a while, but sitting on my my backlog for too long, and I start playing it even on the Vita, so it's very good to play in that one. And the game is amazing, the animations are incredible, the design for the game is fun to play. It's one of the few Metroid games that you play that it's not straightforward, but it's still puzzle, and also that you have to think about where you have to go, what you have to do. There's some good puzzles around it, and the boss fights, they just work well with the gun mechanics.
What's the name of the game again?
Iconoclast.
Oh,
so it's very good to play, because it's just like you're playing a Contra game, but it's inside the Metroidvania framework, so it works well. So the shooting between the bosses is not that intense, but when you get to the bosses, they are very fun to play. There's some very good ones to fight, and let's say it's kind of memorable. And I feel strange that people don't talk more often about this game. It's not as underrated as the one that Shmup Junkie mentioned, but still a game that, yeah, a lot of people played it, but it's not, let's say, as famous as, let's say, Bloodstained or others that got a lot more PR back in the day.
I see. Okay, so I think it's my turn. I have a couple of entries for this. Actually, I cannot pick one. So the run and gun. I'm not sure if it's exactly a run and gun, but I don't know. I think it could be considered. That was released this year that I like a lot is Hunt Down.
Oh, I've never heard of that one.
Hunt Down.
Yeah, me neither.
It's a pretty cheesy 80s style. It's like an 80s movie, like, I don't know, RoboCop or Terminator or whatever. And you play one of the characters look like Tina Turner. And you play, it's so cheesy, so 80-ish that I end up liking it. It reminds me of, I don't know, something I could play on a Genesis or on a SNES, but it's very well refined.
Yeah, it really looks like a 16-bit game.
It's very well refined, very polished game, and I really liked it. I have it for the Switch, and I got it for the Steam Deck as well, because like it's very good.
Yeah, it's on sale on Steam, by the way.
Yeah, it's on Steam. It's on sale, yes. It's a pretty good game. But I also had another game that I ended up playing just in 2022. It's not a 2022 game. I think it's from 2019. This one, I definitely loved it. It's Valfaris.
I haven't played that one either.
This is a running gun. It's, as a metalhead, I have to say, this game is all you can wish for a game.
What was it? Val, did you say...
Valfaris.
Oh, Valfaris. Oh, of course. Yeah, that game was popular when it came out. I remember it. That game's awesome.
I didn't play it back in the day, like when it was released, and I just played it in 2022. Man, it's amazing. Like it's
the cover is already very heavy metal.
No, the game itself has a very good art direction, very good sound design. The songs are really good from the guy from Celtic Frost, and the I don't know. You know when you start playing a game, usually there's those like platformers, running gun or whatever. You start playing them and they're very punishing, and you just like want to give up and stop playing and say, "Ah, I'll get back later." I don't know. This game makes you get back for more all the time, and and even if it's a platformer, it has like an it's a kind of an the story is pretty simple, and but they're like the elements like just like talk to each other very well. I don't know. I think the guys definitely hit the spot in this game.
Yeah, and you might be excited. And do you know they're coming out with the sequel like in a year?
Yes.
The shmup. Oh my god, a sequel to a game? Are you sure?
Yeah.
That's not only a sequel, but it's going to be a shmup.
Yeah,
it looks like a shmup. Yeah,
and it looks like it's going to be like something in the likes of Lords of Thunder, if I'm not wrong.
Wow. Yeah, it's kind of like it has like a lot of melee in it. Like it's kind of like a mix of shmup and like melee fighting, but you're flying and you're in the air. It's kind of interesting.
It's Soul Divide.
Yeah. Soul Divide, but good.
Well, we don't know yet. It could be just Soul Divide.
I hope not.
Well, I'm shocked to hear that, because if there's ever a successful indie game, don't they just make DLC packs for it for 10 years and then maybe a sequel after that?
But yeah, if you played Valfaris, you can imagine like there's probably lots of people like waiting for more, because the game ends in a cliffhanger and it's so crazy that You know the kind of cliffhanger that made people like shout when XLA 2 never came out.
It's kind of
the same thing. Like they send you all the way in full speed, like towards the cliffhanger, and they just like leave you waiting for more. You know,
like when playing Guilty Gear Xrd and half of the endings are kind of okay, let's play, you need to play Xrd 2 or Rev 2 so that you can get the follow-up.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, not cool.
But I want to talk about one more game. It's because I mentioned that could be like a rail shooter. I like calling them rail shmups just to piss people off. But anyway, it's a game called X-Zodiac.
That looks
like something that like a modern version of Star Fox. But it's definitely, I think it's better. Like I really think they enjoyed, they made the formula, they improved the formula a lot.
I actually didn't like it as much as, well, Star Fox 1 is kind of janky, so that one's a little hard to judge. But again, Star Fox 64, I thought it was actually quite a bit of a step down compared to 64.
Yeah.
My biggest problem with, I want to hear your thoughts, but like what you think about this, but my biggest problem with the X-Zodiac and why I kind of cooled towards it is it felt too straightforward, because like you'll be going through and you can kind of just do everything. Like there's enough, you can kill all the enemies, you can do everything. And what I think is really cool about like Sin and Punishment is it's literally impossible to kill all the enemies in a lot of Sin and Punishment stages. So you have to sort of create routes to just make the best of what's possible. But in EX Zodiac, it felt like, oh no, just do this and you've done. It's figured out. You know, I felt like they could have added more enemies and made it a little bit more dynamic, I guess.
I think for like a small game from a small studio, they did well. But yeah, I agree. There should be more content, I guess. There should be more things to do in the game, let's say that.
Yeah. But it was a lot of fun. I had a lot of fun with it too. So it's not finished though, right? It's actually like a beta or whatever, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So there's still time.
Yeah.
Hopefully.
Okay. So, Junkie, did you say your entry?
I did. I think I started. It was, we were talking about running guns, right? Super Cyborg.
Okay. Yeah. You said Super Cyborg. Okay. All right. So for the fifth one, the non-shmup. So because I'm trying to, you know, this is something I'm trying on my channel. I'm trying to show people that we just don't play shmups. We play other stuff as well, because some people sometimes ask me, yeah, oh, you only play shmups? I say, no way. And I'm trying to maybe show them that, yeah, we play other stuff too. So what would be your non-shmup that you recommend? This one must be from 2022, please.
Paulo has to go first.
Okay. Paulo, you're so crazy to go first. Go.
Okay, so for me, the one that surprised me, that I enjoyed a lot, was Ghostwire Tokyo. So it's out for the PlayStation 5 now, should be out for the Xbox a moment later. And it's a non-shmup, but still you're fighting spirits using some sort of mystic powers that you kind of shoot against them. So it's kind of an FPS vibes, but it's a very cool game, and it looks like you're really immersed in Tokyo, and there's a lot of Japanese lore and stories about ghosts and types of evil spirits and everything. So Anyone interested by this type of Japanese culture, it's fun to play because of that. And the graphics there looks great. This PS5, ray tracing everywhere. So the game looks gorgeous. And the fighting is fun to play. It's not, let's say, very difficult, but a satisfying game and something that I really enjoyed playing this year.
Let me tell you another thing about another fun fact about Paulo. You know that friend that know Japanese and know how to finish, how to play Japanese RPGs and dating simulators and whatever? Yeah, that's Paulo.
Oh, come on, don't get me embarrassed in front of everyone here.
Embarrassed? I thought he would be proud. No, he's, you know, that guy that knows Japanese and say, ah, I'm going to beat this just because it's in Japanese and nobody did it. And yeah, he's the guy.
That's impressive.
I wish. I always, it's like one of my life goals, like learn Japanese just so I can play all these games and understand them that I wasn't able to play or understand when I was younger.
Yeah, he's the guy. He's the guy you can refer when you start playing. I want to play something 100% purely Japanese, that not just the language barrier, but the cultural barrier. You have to talk to Paulo.
Yeah. And I'm the friend that calls Ryu. And I call Pokemon. And I just do all the things that drive like people who are really sensitive about that stuff up the wall. So
start calling rail shooters rail shmups. People will
rail
try to
shmups, yeah. Oh, I say shmups. That drives people crazy. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm that type of guy.
All right. Who wants to be the next? Okay, could be me. I'm always saying this. Okay. My recommendation would be, of course, I could say Hades, just because I'm really playing it and enjoying it, but it would be way too obvious because I guess everyone else is playing Hades. So, so
my friend played Hades all when it came out, whatever that year was. He played it all year. Like,
yeah, that would be pretty.
That game is so popular.
Yeah, that would be pretty bland. So, I have to recommend something, and it's an FPS. It's an FPS called Metal Hellsinger. If you never played or if you're into FPS, this is pretty interesting. Mm. I found it interesting because first, it looks like the art direction is pretty good. I think the it looks like a very Doom-ish style. But the fun fact about this game is it's also a rhythm game. So you'll be listening to music.
Really?
Yeah. And when you shoot, like you're holding your mouse and you're shooting, and every time you shoot and you hit together and your shots match the drums, you do more damage. And the more that's accurate cool. you shoot, the more damage you do. You start doing combos.
And, oh, that's cool.
And it starts adding layers to the music.
So probably they did the rest right.
Yeah. So you start listening to it, and you start in, like, the more you shoot, you start listening to a new guitar, a new bass, a vocal or something. They start to the better you play, they start adding layers to the game music. It's amazing. It's available only on Steam, and it's
PS5 as well.
Oh yeah, PS5.
Oh,
and maybe Xbox as well, but I don't know.
I don't know. Let me see. Yeah, that's on Xbox, PlayStation 4. It's not out on the Switch, although.
Okay, that's my entry.
Go for it, Mark.
All righty. I like to be volunteered. So I have two picks. The first pick, I have been trying to review the game all year, but just keep having to cover other stuff. But I am going to review it, is a really cool game called Hyper Demon. And it's the sequel to Devil Daggers. First person, the graphics are surreal and amazing. And it's one of the best looking games I've ever seen in my life. And I say that and people say, oh, that's because the game looks insane and crazy and it's over the top and it blows your eyeballs out of your head. And I think that's really bold. And I really appreciate that. And I was really worried how they're going to follow Devil Daggers up. I'm a big fan of Devil Daggers. Because I was afraid they're going to make it kind of look that generic 3D that everything looks like. And I was like, oh, God. But Hyper Demon, no. They did not do that. They went out on a limb. And I think it's amazing. And it builds up on Devil Daggers gameplay really well. I'm not as good at it as I am at Devil Daggers. So I can't fully confirm which one's better gameplay-wise. But it is really cool. And I'm going to do a whole video about it here soon. So Hyper Demon was one. And then the second one, absolutely unexpected for me is the new Gungrave game that came out, Gungrave Gore. I know everyone was giving it bad reviews. I will tell you, ever since that game came out, I've been playing that bitch every night instead of doing other stuff. Beat the entire thing. Then I beat it on hard mode. Well, most of it on hard mode. Then I unlocked Gore mode, which is the hardest mode. Beat in the entire Gore mode. And when you beat the entire Gore mode, you unlock a hidden character, Brandon Heat. And now I'm going through and I'm going to beat Brandon Heat Gore mode. I mean, and that as they've been going, they've actually been patching it. They added in cell shading. They fixed up a lot of the jank with it. Like, the game is actually really awesome. And so I'm actually considering posting a long play of me beating Gore mode with Brandon Heat just because I've been doing that all night. But yeah, so that's an unexpected surprise for me, but I really like that game a lot. So Gungrave Gore.
Interesting. I can't say I have a great contribution for this one, but I've been so busy lately, especially in making videos, that unless I'm making a video about a game, I don't have a lot of free time to play other games, which is unfortunate. It's kind of like you're playing what you're making videos about, and there's not a lot of free time.
That's how I am now, too.
Yeah, it's like you want like other games you kind of want to play. The only free time I really do when I play my own stuff or is when I'm hanging out in the evenings with my wife and the dogs, and we're just, you know, okay, what game are we going to play tonight? That came out. So, you know, I don't get a lot of free time. And I think, so my pick would be pretty easy and obvious because it's everyone's played it, that AAA title. That only new game that I really had time to play through all the way this year, it came out this year, was Elden Ring. Just because, you know, everybody played it.
Forgot Elden Ring came out.
You even forgot he played it. I mean, so I don't really need to talk about Elden Ring. Everybody knows what it is. Everybody knows the game, but I wasn't always a big Souls player, but Bloodborne is like my all-time favorite, like PS4 release. I just, when that game came out, I played the hell out of it and I loved it. And I never got into the Souls games too much. They were a little too, I don't know, something about them didn't live up to like Bloodborne. Like that game just did it for me because it was aggressive. And I had a really good time with Elden Ring because it was kind of a mix of that aesthetic and it was a little more open. I can kind of go and do whatever I wanted and have a good time with it. So, and I only have like about an hour and a half each evening to play. So it's kind of like, I played it in these little bits. I didn't get to binge it. So it's like, okay, we're going to play for an hour tonight. We're going to play for 2 hours tonight, 2 hours. Mm-hmm. And eventually over the course of months, you know, eventually it's a long game. We got through it and it's a good game. I had a good time with it. It's not perfect. I didn't like it as much as Bloodborne, but that was my game that, my 2022 game that I got to play this year that wasn't something I'm making a video about.
No, that's the answer we wanted.
Yeah, I talked about this when we did a whole podcast about Elden Ring, yelling at each other about it. And I said that Elden Ring, you know, it's really popular and it's really broken into the mainstream when random people in Idaho start talking about a game because people in Idaho aren't big gamers. And I went to a baby's birthday party. And at the baby's birthday party, some of the dads there were like, have you played this game Elden Ring? And it blew their mind. They're like, it was so funny. It's so funny to hear people who aren't gamers like explaining games to you and explaining Elden Ring. It was worth it just for that. But if it's making it to that type of crowd who normally will only play Call of Duty, like my brothers, that means it's had some real crossover.
Yeah. I wonder how many people have played it, actually played it all the way through or got to finish it. Probably very few.
Few. Yeah. I know I did.
You can check that out on Steam or PS4 because you can see the achievements.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
You could spy on people.
That's true.
Yeah, that's true.
All right. Who wants to be the next?
I think we're on the next category.
Next category. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Next category will be pretty straightforward. Shmup of the year. From all that we talked about, or we didn't talk about, maybe it's something else you want to talk about. What would be your shmup of the year?
I'm going to choose this. I'm going to go first, so I beat you all to it. Gunvane is my shmup of the year by quite a margin. Not just like, oh, maybe. This one was very easy. Some years it's kind of hard, like, oh, there's a lot of contenders. This year, by quite a margin, it was Gunvane. So absolutely my shmup of the year. for sure. I've had so much fun playing it. I want to do more videos about it, but I'm waiting for the console release to do them. So, yeah, I absolutely love Gunvane. That's my shmup of the year.
Yep. I think that Gunvane is awesome, and the only reason I wouldn't choose it as a shmup of the year, not because not necessarily the best, but because of more my personal preference towards games. You know, I'm more into the traditional style. So, like, I'll play Gunvane and I'll love it and it'll kick my ass, but I'll only come back to like that style of game so much, as opposed to something like Softstar, for example, just because, you know, it's more my bag, if that makes sense, you know. So I'll come back to Androdunas 2, and I'll come back to Softstar, and I'll come back to Gunvane. You said they're all amazing, but if I'm going to pick something different than Mark, you know, and give them some good publicity because they deserve it, you know, and that would be Softstar, because it's just a great game all around, and it's the amount of content is like surreal almost for that style of game, you know, to keep coming back to.
One thing I want to add about Softstar too is that I think it's really cool that it's from South America. And I think it's really cool that we're seeing this new, at least I am perceiving it this way, I might be wrong, but like this new wave of South American arcade games that are just awesome, you know, like Fight and Rage. I always pair it with Fight and Rage in my mind, even though they're from different places. But, you know, this area of the world it's really cool because there's so much arcade roots from South America, especially talking to ShmupsBR about his experience in Brazil and everything. I think we're going to see a lot of really cool stuff like this coming out soon. It's not just going to be Japan and Europe.
No, I hope not. Honestly, I have a lot of things that I know about, a lot of games that are being developed at the moment. I cannot talk about them. But yes, there's very interesting things coming. You can look forward.
There's actually one other game I wanted to mention, kind of like an honorable mention, because it didn't technically come out this year. It's out, but it's not out on Steam until next year, but it's a game we've all been playing already, but it also deserves, you know, because it's deserved it ever since it came out, and that's been Shieldmaid. I know a lot of you guys have played it. It's just so incredibly unique and well designed and different. You know, it was doing what Drainus was doing before Drainus was doing it.
I thought that when Drainus came out, I was like, hey, real overlap here.
Because it's out, but like it's only really out within the shmup community, because it wasn't available on Steam yet. It's not out on consoles yet. So unless you're getting it on itch.io, most people don't really know about it yet. Mm-hmm. But it's getting its official Steam release and, you know, everything and more next year. Like I said, it's such a deep game that you can just keep playing and playing, you know, gameplay wise, that it just deserves to be mentioned. And it will be mentioned next year, I'm sure, when it's officially out.
Do you know if they're doing any updates to it for the Steam version, or is it just like pretty close?
They're constantly updating it. So yeah, because every time like I go to talk about the game, they're like, oh, well, let me give you the latest stuff because we've changed this, you know.
Interesting.
There's so many people playtesting it, and they're testing it and scoring that. Yeah, like they're always updating more and more with the game.
On the topic, just to compliment something on the topic of South America, I have two things to say. Softstar 2, and keep an eye on something called Moon Rider, if you like ninjas.
Oh, cool.
Awesome.
He's from the same guys that made Burning Chrome.
Oh, really? Blazing Chrome?
Yeah.
Oh, so is Blazing Chrome South American as well?
Yes.
Oh, my God.
The same thing that made... clone?
Moon Riders.
I was really close to mentioning Blazing Chrome in the Running Gun section, but I'm like, everyone's played Blazing Chrome.
Yeah, Moon Rider is going to be their Shinobi game.
Oh, that's going to be really cool.
The art is fantastic. I saw some designs. It's looking amazing. And of course, Softstar 2, but there's not much I can talk about it.
There's another Shinobi game coming out, like, supposedly next year, if it's finished in time, that I keep seeing called Bushiden, and, like, it looks really cool, too. Like, nobody can play it yet. It's still early, but it looks like it has a lot of potential as well.
Okay, Paulo, your turn?
Yes, my turn, then. So I will second Shmup Junkie, Softstar, my Shmup of the Year. Even though I did love Drainus a lot for several reasons, I think that Softstar is kind of the release that people were not expecting outside of the beta team. So everyone was kind of surprised. Outside
okay, that's of a, Brazil, nobody knew Brazil, about it. Yeah.
So nobody knew about it. So it was cool to see like a game that was not made by Joy Masher being released out in the wild and have like a very good positive reception. And one thing that's cool to talk about, let's say people doing games into these remote parts of the planet, that there's no major publisher behind them. So mm-hmm. if you take like Team Ladybug in Japan, they did Drainius, but they had like a publisher supporting them to do the game. So they had funding to do the game. The guys doing Softstar, they were doing that in their spare time. They did that over 2 years. They were working at night. I knew saw several of the people working on the game, and they were working like Saturday, Sunday, so they whatever time they had free, they were doing that. If they got some work to do for something else that would pay them, they would take that and postpone the game a little bit so that they could pay the bills and utilities. So that's kind of the story behind the game that makes it even more incredible that it's a great game, it's out, and it deserves at least respect from the shooting community. So that's something that we have to mention when we talk about Softstar. It's not only that the game is great, but it was developed under the most, let's say,
extreme conditions.
Underfunded extreme conditions. So now try to picture if that team had, like, let's say, proper funding, being able to work full time on the game for 6 months, 8 months, and say, okay, this is our job. So this is not the kind of people doing Softstar, and they did that amazing job.
And the, there's another fun fact about Softstar. One of the guys, one of the graphic designers, also worked on Shredder's Revenge.
Interesting.
Yeah. Some of the sprites, yeah. you may find some of the colors in the sprites, especially the turtle ship, reminds of something familiar with you.
I would say about Shredder's Revenge, I don't like the gameplay at all, but I love the graphics. So that guy is doing some hard carrying for that game, because graphics are fantastic.
Did you see the sprite for the real true boss in Softstar?
I believe I did, because I won CC'd it, so I probably did, but my mind's a little hazy.
It's like a Japanese demon, a huge one.
Oh, that's awesome. Yeah, that's awesome.
No, that's one of the most beautiful sprites I've seen in my entire life.
And that most people won't be able to see it unless they watch a YouTube video.
I have a question, since you have insider information. Did the guys from Softstar, did anyone work on that Super Galaxy Squadron game?
Not that I am aware.
Just because their graphical styles really remind me of each other, and could I always be. Wondered if there was a connection.
I can talk to the guys. Styles. I'm not sure about it, but I can talk to the guys.
Yeah, because check them out. Check viewers at home. Look at Super Galaxy Squadron and look at Softstar and look at their graphics. There's so much there mm-hmm. that seems so similar.
Could be. I can check this information for you. Okay. My picks. I don't want to, I guess, like you guys probably picked up my picks as well. It would be absolutely impossible for me to pick between Softstar and Gunvane, because I kind of participated on both on the same way. So I don't know. You could call me an emotional guy or something, but I get this kind of connection to things when I participate on them. And I don't know. I love them both. I had a great time playing both, and it will be absolutely unfair on my side if I pick one. So I consider it a draw.
Cool. I'll accept that.
It's our channel. You do whatever you want.
Yes.
Yeah, draws are acceptable. I made them acceptable. All right. okay. And last but not the least, we have the stay away / avoid like the plague section that we want to help you guys not to put your money on things that you shouldn't. So, or at least in our opinion, of course, you are free to play and like whatever you like. I like lots of games that I know they're bad, but we cannot say they're not bad. So who wants to be the first? Mark, it was your idea. You start.
Of course, it was my idea. Okay, so I have one for the people, because another game that people were messaging me a ton about was a game called The Night Witch. And the Night Witch is a bullet hell Metroidvania. And I've always sort of talked about, okay, this could be an interesting combination. Let's give this a go.
No.
Well, I did give it a go. I decided not to make a video about it because I couldn't even stand playing it that long. But I do not recommend this game. The Night Witch is not the best of both worlds. I would consider it the worst of both worlds, where it has this really plodding level design, lots of forced cutscenes, and then the bullet hell sections, like the hitboxes are absurd. Like the hitboxes are like massive, and it's got some inertia. It feels bad to play bullet hell wise, but then even as a Metroidvania, I have played Metroidvanias, and this is why it actually got kind of bad reviews, because I was like, oh, well, I could see it getting bad reviews because it's a shmup and reviewers get mad if shmups are too hard. But most of their viewers were like, eh, you know, the Metroidvania elements aren't good. And I agreed there. It just was not. I mean, they could, you know, maybe try again at the formula. I think the formula could work of a Metroidvania bullet hell, but the Night Witch is not that the golden child to make that happen. So I would say steer clear of it. It is not recommended by my. I didn't even want to do a video on it because I didn't like it. Like, I couldn't stand even playing it long enough to do a video.
I think I have a similar story, but go ahead.
Yeah, so that would be my stay away, no, the Night Witch.
Okay, let me be the next one. I was, lots of people recommended me a game called Returnal for PS5. Yeah.
PS5 exclusive.
People said, no, this is the next big thing. Returnal is amazing. This is going to be like the Xbox, the Steam killer, the whatever killer, your mother's killer, whatever. Play it. And I tried, and it's fucking boring. Like, it's, you know, they just got like a shitload of money. They had like a massive studio behind them with all the tools, all the, you know, story writers, screenplayers, and animators.
Same studio that made that Twin Stick, Next Machina, I think it is. Same
yeah.
studio.
And actually, I love Next Machina, but man, they messed up so badly. Like, the game is first boring. I could stop here, but I won't. The game is annoying in a sense of it, you know, makes you think, why am I playing this? Because you're underpowered, you're helpless, you don't know what you have to do. It have, like you mentioned, the worst of both worlds in terms of a third-person shooter and a Metroidvania. Like, it makes everything to make you get lost in a scenario. Mm. And sometimes the scenario is not obvious and you don't understand what's going on, even if it's beautiful. You just, like, you know, walk from one side to another. They told me it would be like a third-person shooter or with some bullet hell elements. Because
yeah,
like
that's what I've heard. People keep telling me that.
Patterns, the bullet patterns are there. But, like, you know, you fight things for like 10 seconds and you walk the scenario for 1 hour. And then you fight things for another 10 seconds and you walk the scenario for another hour. And you rinse, repeat. So, no. If you get it for free, give it to someone you don't like.
That's good you bring that up, because that's one of those games that's been on my short list, because my brother just got a PS5 and everyone's been asking, oh, what do you think of Returnal? Play Returnal. I was like, well, for a long time I couldn't because I didn't have a PS5. So,
you know, even the name gives you a hint, Returnal. If you get it, return it back to the
Returnal
shop.
Returnal forever.
Return it, refund it.
And you know, it's funny that we talk about that, because I know some friends that they're not into shmups, and they actually enjoy this game for some reason. I always looked at the game and said, okay, this looks bland, I don't care about it. But they were like, oh, this is fun, you should play. It's like a bullet hell in a third person environment. I said, okay, I looked at it, it's not for me. But the guys, there are people who actually like that. So that's kind of funny, because maybe it's not for us, but for some reason, there is an audience for the game.
Yeah, well, it's like when people recommended me Enter the Gungeon for all those years, and I finally played it. I'm like,
yeah, I had the same problem with Returnal. I almost buy the game. I got the game on the PSN Plus, And I said, damn, you know, thank you, Sony, for making me pay for the subscription, because if I had buy this game, I would be pretty upset.
And you also mentioned Enter the Gungeon. It's a, maybe it's a generational thing. My son, he loves that game. He has beaten Enter the Gungeon from the inside out. Whatever you can think about doing that game, he probably made it already. And he has friends who played that as well. So they are into those roguelite games that you have to build up your character. Mm-hmm. I find that boring because for me, it's me who needs to build up the skills to play the game. Not I have to build up the skills of the character so that I can actually play the game. Like most of the, some of the beaten ups that they do right now and everything that's roguelike at the moment, but they like it. So it's not for us, I would say, but still, for some reason, there are people who enjoy this kind of game.
Yeah, I think if you play a lot of roguelikes, I'm sure it's more geared to that audience rather than a shmup audience. It's like a roguelike with some shmup elements, but it's, you can't just hand it to a shmup player and be like, here you go, enjoy. It's not quite the same thing, I don't think. What's yours, Paolo?
I'm having a hard time to pick this one because I usually try to avoid any game that I see the video and I don't like. But if I have to say one game that came out this year, which is not a new release, but I feel like people should avoid if they can play the, you know, the emulated version somewhere else, is the Cotton 2 release and Guardian Force by City Connection.
Yes.
One, let's say I was waiting for the patch. Okay, so let's maybe see if they can get it right. And I saw it and say, okay, no, it's still bad. So I don't know why they made that, because it's really, really bad port.
I think they can only fix it by absolutely just redoing it, because the way they ported it was they're emulating. So Cotton 2 is already a laggy game on the Dreamcast just in itself. And then they're using a super laggy emulator on top of that. So you're getting a double smack of lag.
Yeah, so there's more to add to this.
It's not fun to play. It's not fun at all.
There's more to add to this story. The same guys messed up with Elevator Action Returns and Layer Section on Saturn.
Yes, because they're using that same emulator.
Yeah.
I'm going to fight the camera a little bit, sorry.
They did the same thing 3 times.
I think they're going to keep doing it, though, because I'm pretty sure they can just take the ISO file, drag, drop. Yeah. Here we go.
And someone will pay for it.
People wouldn't even know that it's broken because they don't have the point of reference of the original game. They would just say, oh, it's working fine. I suck playing this game. That's going to be their reaction. They'll just put back into the shelf, say, oh, it's a nice game, looks good, but I suck playing it. But it's actually the game that's really bad to play in that form.
But the thing had like 95 frames of delay, so you probably will notice at some point that the game is unplayable.
You would think that, but when I did my review of it and I showed the game had like, at the time, 11 or 12 frames of lag, I did have people in the comments being like, so what? Yeah. What's your problem? I'm like, okay, this is absurd.
And we're back to the input lag discussion.
Yeah, I was kind of disappointed because I was looking forward to that release too. Because I mean, those games are not that easy to emulate. I mean, first of all, the two Cotton games and Guardian Force are really good games, and they're not that they don't always emulate well. They're kind of buggy. You know, they have their delay of their own, so there's no great way to play it unless you have a Saturn, really. I think it was really looking forward to having that pack available and done well, and it wasn't, unfortunately.
I bought this game.
I bought it, but I reviewed it, so I feel like that's okay.
Yeah.
What are your
trash talk it?
Yeah, I don't want to say. I think people started to think I have something against City Connection, but
you know how you hit call City Connection, right?
They're hit and miss, where you can't trust them, but they can sometimes do a good job. So you always have to kind of check.
Yeah, they're ex-Jollicles, right?
I don't know where they're from.
Yeah, they are.
I think they are Jollicles.
They were people who were working at Jaleco. Then they did the company called City Connect because it is a Jaleco game. And they bought back part of the catalog of Jaleco, and they have been doing games.
Well, why don't they port Pretty Sailor Moon Beat? Oh, because it's the IP. But
yeah,
that's my one of my favorite Jalico games. Port that one.
I haven't played, besides what Paolo already mentioned, like I said, that's probably the only new release that I've played this year that I was kind of disappointed with the port job and everything else that went down with it. So I can't pick a new 2022 release that I was disappointed with, but I can pick a game that I'd played for the first time that I was expecting to be bad, and it was as bad as I expected it to be, and that was for my Mega Drive. You guys will appreciate this because you know the Amiga, and I had never played it before, was Xenon 2. And I'd had to play that for my Mega Drive, every Mega Drive shooter reviewed video, and it was definitely as bad as I was told and had expected it would be. So I don't think anyone's rushing or going to be going out to play that game anyway, but I can only confirm
that I have
probably want to avoid it. Funny enough, there were people in the comments that are like, oh, that game is great, I loved it. You know,
you're always going to be there, no matter how bad it is, there's always someone in the comments.
Nostalgia is a hell of a drug.
Let me tell you, there's
plenty of games that I used to play that I will readily admit that I like just because I played them as a kid, but they're terrible games. And I'll admit that they're terrible games. I just happen to like them.
I think we should sometime do another podcast saying like shitty games, but I like them. That would be a fun one.
Yeah. Enter the Matrix. How about that?
That's kind of like what I'm playing right now.
Let me tell you a fun story about Xenon 2. It was 1993, and I got my first and only Amiga. And in Brazil, it was very hard to get Amiga games. And I managed to talk to a guy, and the guy was selling me the Amiga, but he was just like a computer retailer. He wasn't like a game seller. He didn't have games. And I said, man, I'm going to get the Amiga for Christmas. Could you please give me a game? Otherwise, I'll have to sit until, I don't know, January. I would spend like a week or two like looking at the desktop without nothing to play with. And he said, oh, I have a good game here for you.
Xenon 2.
And I played
Xenon afterward.
Yeah, no, I played Xenon 2 from 24th of December until probably the first week of January, and I beat it.
Oh, man.
Because it was the only thing I had on my computer. I had nothing else to play. And today, if someone tortured me, I won't play Xenon 2. And by the way, do you know, Google for the ending.
You must have loved that ending.
Google for the ending.
That's the kind of ending you can only appreciate if you actually grinded it like you did to beat it fair and square. I wasn't even about to try that for a video. I had no interest after like the third level.
When people say sometimes nowadays I'm playing something and people say, oh, but this game is bad. I say, well, man, I beat Xenon 2. I'm calibrated in a different way. I beat Xenon 2 back in the day, so I don't care, man. This is way better than Xenon 2.
My problem as a kid was
I even refused to play bad games when I was a kid. Like, we'd get a bad game, and I would just play the same good games over and over and over and over and over rather than play bad games. So I didn't have too many of those. I think the one that stands out to me is Enter the Matrix. Other than that, I can't think of any like really bad games that I played a lot when I was a kid.
You're lucky. We played a lot of bad games.
That's a bad one.
Yeah. Growing up in the 80s and 90s, that was hard.
Well, sometimes it was like your bad choice. It's like, okay, well, your family can only afford one game for the next, X amount of months or whatever. So you've been waiting, researching, like, okay, this game looks awesome. It's on the shelf. I'm going to buy this Nintendo game. So I buy it because it's got, dinosaurs on the cover, and I like dinosaurs, and it's by Hudson Soft, and I bring it home, and it ends up being Adventures of Dino Ricky.
Oh my
and
God.
Let me tell you, I actually like that game now. I like it quite a bit because it kicked my ass and I can play it. But
I actually did buy, speaking of bad games, this one's a legendary one. I actually did buy Superman 64 as a kid. and I tried so hard to beat that game. So,
you was so the guy busted. Who bought Superman 64.
I was the man.
You are the guy who messed up with the statistics.
I just couldn't understand. Like, my brain could not understand that a game could be that broken. So I just like, what's wrong? Like, I couldn't figure it out. I never could beat it. But holy crap. I didn't like it, but I was like determined to beat it.
My brother was totally crazy about Street Fighter 2 back in the day, but we had an NES. And one day he gathered all the money that a, I don't know, 12-year-old kid could gather, and he bought Street Fighter 2010.
Oh, jeez.
I remember that.
Sad story.
Ripped off.
Sad story.
I don't remember that game being horrible. I just remember being disappointing because you're expecting something to do with Street Fighter and has nothing to do with Street Fighter. So play it and you're like, what is this?
You order a burger and you get a sushi. That's what happens. Okay. Who else is missing? Junkie and Paulo, if I'm not wrong. It's 2 o'clock in the morning here. Sorry if I'm missing something, guys.
I think we got that topic covered.
Yep.
Okay. We got everything covered. Okay. I have a small stretch for you guys just because I'm myself. And I didn't prepare you for this. So I think we can get full sincerity here. I added a secret topic here just to make sure. Well, 2023 is pretty promising. We have so many great games coming out. And what is the game you are expecting for 2023? Could be a shmup. Let's keep it in the shmup area because like there's so many. What is the game you're looking forward in 2023?
That's new game that's coming out.
Yes. I will answer for myself and from Paulo, Alessi Branch. Okay, you guys can go.
Hell no, you got it right.
Found out about on Christmas, which is Dodonpachi Daijo, Blissful Death. Yes. My opinion, the greatest shmup of all time, is getting a port by M2 Shot Triggers, the best porting team of all time. So I'm expecting 2023 may hold one of the greatest games of all time. So that is absolutely what I'm looking forward to. I am already like planning shit, and it's like coming out whenever. I'm already like planning my reviews and doing like a whole bonanza around that release. I'm super excited for that.
The PS2 Dodonpachi, right?
Yes, but the PS2 version is missing Black Label, first of all. Second of all, you know, M2 Shot Triggers, they bring the heat, so it's going to have extra stuff, save states, hopefully in a range mode. It's going to be more accessible outside the PS2, of course. They always have really fantastic performance in terms of accuracy and in low input lag. I mean, it's just all that you could ask for. So some of my favorite games of all time are Battle Grega Rev 2016, Ketsui Destiny, and I'm suspecting this DOJ port will be in that list. So that could just come out next year and I'd be happy. I don't really care about anything else so much right now.
Yeah, unfortunately, it's only going to be for Christmas. So that's the only thing that's kind of a buggers.
Yeah, so to be honest, there's something else I'd like to see because it's on, I think, probably everyone's radar at this point, but they are keeping it secret. The next Truxton game.
The next Truxton game?
Yeah, the author, I forgot the name of the guy. He hinted that he's... Yeah, Masahiro Yugi hinted that he's working on the next on Truxton 3, but he said nothing about it. So I'd like to see something else.
Yeah, I wouldn't hold your breath on that.
Junkie and him are like best friends, so Junkie would know.
Well, it's not that he's you're absolutely right. He's mentioned on multiple occasions that he would love to do Truxton 3. And it's not that he won't, but it's one of those things where even if the budget is there, like he has to be ready and he has to feel like he can do it justice. So I think it's one of those things where he would love to do it. And if all the stars align and the opportunity presents itself and he feels like he can make the Truxton 3 that it deserves to be, then he would. But definitely don't, it's not in development. You know, it's not something that like anything, but he's secretly working on and, all of a sudden going to be come out. If it was going to happen, you can bet I would probably announce it with the documentary.
That would be great.
And believe me, if
it
Yeah, and believe me, if it was, I would just keep my mouth shut because I wouldn't be allowed to like let that go. So I'm just saying outright, you know, it's like we all know he's publicly said that he has the desire to do it, but it's not like a secret project that's in the works. You know, it's not something where he's in the background doing this. You know, he's older, he's got a lot going on with his life, so he wants to do it, but it's not an easy task. You know, it's also quite an ask.
I believe the very nature of the game is hard because like nowadays everyone made a Truxton. Like if you go for if you look for like the amount of Truxton clones we have, like it would be pretty hard to make some a Truxton that's more Truxton than Truxton, you know.
Yeah.
It would have
you just Truxton harder? Like you just get even crazier with it, or that
and really you have to consider that Truxton 2 wasn't really his game. You know, he did the music for Truxton 2, but he didn't program it. So, you know, the Truxton 3 would be like his Truxton 3 would be, you know, like Truxton 1, or at least that was his vision of the game. In Super terms Truxton. Of the gameplay and how it worked. You know, because obviously Truxton 2 had its, you know, detractors too. It's definitely got its issues on the gameplay
side. But it's also one of the craziest shmups ever made.
Oh, yeah.
And it has its lovers, too. I mean, that game is so interesting.
Yeah, very much so. So, I mean, I think we'd all love to see a Truxton 3. I mean, a lot of people would lose their shit if they found out it's coming.
Yeah.
And maybe someday it will. You know, maybe this documentary will do really, really well and it'll help finance something like that. You know, who knows? You know, so there's a lot of possibilities, but as of now, I'm not aware of anything actually happening in the background. Unless the branch, on the other hand, is obviously happening, and I think we're all excited for it. I think people are jumping the gun, thinking that it's going to come out in 23, because anytime a trailer says, please wait a little longer in Japanese, that means they've got a lot of work to do. I know they'd like to, but I mean, they probably won't release it until they feel it's ready. And if it comes out in 23, I'll be thrilled. But I'm also kind of prepared for like.
And they already have like two games to release in 23. They have the Race Collection, and they have to release the Dio Jokola part. So that's already two releases from them.
Oh, and they're gonna have to release another Toll Plan Collection probably because they've been releasing one every year. So that's another one. Include not anything else that they're working on.
So so three games plus whatever else they are working on.
They have a lot on their plate at this point, I guess.
It's different people working on it too. You know, the programmer on Alesta Branch is obviously not the same person doing these other games. You know, they all have someone else, but
and they have some infrastructure. Like Ketsui runs on the PGM, DOJ runs on the PGM, so they probably have a lot of code already ready to go from the Ketsui port that they can use towards the DOJ port. I'm assuming.
That's true.
Yeah, also, another release that I'm really looking forward to in 2023, I don't know if it's announced for 2023, is this documentary about Toplan.
Oh, yeah.
Right. I'm looking forward to seeing that shit. It's a shmup in all but controls.
Yeah, it's definitely doing well. It's on track. So, I mean, there's not too many interviews left to do. You know, a lot of it's been done, and there's going to be a lot of editing on my part once it's already. You know, and it'll definitely be a crunch to get it out in time, but I think we'll do our best. And, you know, I think everyone will just want to wait and make sure it's the best product it can be. So there's that. But I can promise you that when it does come out, you will see Tsuneki Ikeda playing Truxton on a real cabinet, kicking its ass. And
awesome.
It'll be awesome. So that's been filmed and it will happen.
I'm looking forward to that strictly. I mean, for a lot of reasons, but one just really hidden benefit is that I'm assuming it's going to have footage of some of these developers. And whenever you're doing a video and you want to show like a screenshot of the developer, like, oh, you know, Ikeda, there's like one photo of him in the office that's like 400 by 400 pixels that you have to keep using. It's like, oh, we could get some footage of this man. So when we say Ikeda in a video, we could have like a nice face to put there.
Yeah, and now you'll have like this 20, 30 minute long, like dedicated special interview of like him and, you know, all Toll Plan.
That's going to be really cool.
Which I've gotten to see and I'm not allowed to talk about, but I've seen it all translated and I get to put it together and make something cool out of it.
Poor Junkie. That's probably a lot of effort, a lot of work to do in this to get it done, I guess.
I just imagine Junkie chained to his desk editing every day.
And then you wonder why I don't have time to play any new games.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, I don't have either, but, you know, I every now and then I have to say, I have to tell myself, no, you're not going to edit videos today. You're going to play games. And otherwise, like, you know, you all guys know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, that train has sailed for me. Now I just say, you have to add videos today. No gaming.
Yeah.
That's my life now.
All right, guys. I think that's what I had planned for today, even with a stretch. So I think that's it. Well, thank you very much for participating. If do you guys want to add something or say a message to the Brazilian community? Of course, this video is going to be directed for the international viewers as well, but this channel is too from Brazil, so. Oh. You know, Paulo, you talk to the Brazilian community all the time.
Yeah. So I will start then. I will speak in English so that the international community can listen to me, and then you will just add subtitles.
Hopefully, oh, by the way, Paulo is not in Brazil. He's in Canada.
Yes, I'm in Canada, so I'm also an expat like Felipe. So for me, let's say, Felipe, thanks for inviting. Shmup Junkie, Mark, thanks so much for being here as well. Nice to finally talk to you. Not in person, but like live, like we're doing today. It's acceptable doing that over chat, so it was a nice opportunity. And also, I like to mention that it was really cool to be able to share what each other thought about the year, what were the best games, the worst games. And incredibly, we all keep track of everything that we believe is coming out, but when we sit here like together, we talk, oh, there is this game I didn't know about, so let's try to play it because it looks cool. So I will definitely look back to this video and pick up some names that I just heard and check the photo so that I can play later. And for the people in Brazil watching this video, come on, guys, you are a great community for shmups. I know that there are Facebook groups, there is WhatsApp, Telegram groups. You should keep playing the style, the genre. You should keep going strong on this one, because there is only one way that shmup devs can survive and will thrive, which is basically if people get their games. If you don't get the shmups you like, man, forget it. The genre is done, because this is a very niche market. We are very small, and especially for the Brazilian developers, go out there and buy the game on Steam, because they deserve your attention.
All right.
All right. Yeah. I guess I'll go. I'll make it quick. I didn't know much about the shmup community, you know, beyond 2 years ago when I started making videos. You know, I was kind of in my own little world, and as I was isolated, I wasn't on Discord. You know, I was just playing my games, and, you know, I didn't really know too many people. So when I started my channel, it opened up this whole new world of all these other people that I met, starting with Mark, who kind of introduced me to the community and people like Hauser and Felipe and everyone else. And I couldn't believe how passionate the Spanish community especially was about shmups and how huge they are. So the future of the shmup community, as far as development, a big part of that is going to come from South America, I think. Not just Japan or anywhere else. And we're seeing it now with Softstar, just to start. But it's been awesome just meeting you guys and those people. And I've met so many friends. So all I have to say is, when I do eventually come down to visit South America, because I've always wanted to visit Brazil and Peru, and I have a friend in Costa Rica, we're going to have to set something up. We're all going to have to get together and do something. I'd look forward to it, because I'd love to meet some of you guys in person.
Alrighty. All right. Well, I'll go next. So I learned a little bit about the Brazilian community because I did a whole podcast episode with ShmupsBR about his experience in Brazil, and what a wild episode that was. That was awesome. And so, first thing of all is you all should check that out. Make sure it all went well on my part. And I think the Spanish community is really awesome, and I love how passionate Spanish people are. I have Spanish ancestry from the motherland, Spain, but I've always had a lot of real close connections in my life with South Americans from many different countries. So I think you all are super cool. You all are badass at King of Fighters. I respect that as well. I enjoy watching the King of Fighters tournaments where Brazil beats the ass out of the Japanese players. I find that delightful. So keep at it with King of Fighters. You all are super good at Third Strike as well. You're really good at fighting games, arcade games, just absolute monsters. So yeah, I absolutely respect the South American community for all that.
Well, I am probably the only channel that specializes in shmups in Brazil, I guess. Paulo has his channel, but he talks about so many topics, not just shmups. Yeah. He's, of course, we're both shmup-centric, but not shmup-exclusive. But I think I'm probably more towards the shmup-exclusive.
You're really geared towards shmups. I talk about arcades. I talk about modding consoles, fixing things. So, no, you're really the shmup guy.
But what I have to say is I don't agree when Paulo say that we're a niche. I think the shmups are probably one of the first genres. And that's that not just never changed too much, but never died. We saw so many things coming up and dying, being born and dying in the video game community that I think that shmups is probably one of the stronger, if not the strongest genre ever. So in terms of resilience, in terms of keeping up with the market that's so aggressive and so diverse, that's video games nowadays. So Even if we're a small community, I think we're probably a very strong one. And I think we are doing pretty well at the moment. Back in the day, I guess, in the early 2000s, someone told me that shmups were dead. And I can't say this guy was totally wrong. Based on everyone's experience here, I can't say this guy was totally wrong. And also, I don't think if you guys agree with me or not, but I think we are the specialized media, specialized shmup media that exists nowadays. I don't think we probably have people that are as specialized as we are, but I don't think we have people more specialized than we are.
Yeah, definitely not.
Well, we're the media that shmups need because it doesn't properly exist outside, you know, on mainstream reviewers. You know, there's some, like I think what Nintendo Life recently has been using a Super Cancel on Twitter, and he's a serious shmup guy, and he's been doing good reviews, like solid, legit reviews for shmups that have been coming out.
Lasts, though.
But that's rare. It's like
viewers super fast.
But it's few and far between. You know, you rarely get someone like that. It's not going to happen often.
Okay. Well, guys, that's it, I guess. It was a pleasure to talk to you. I hope we have this opportunity to do this, have the opportunity to do this again at some point.
Yeah.
Even if I know we have busy lives, it is pretty hard to allocate time to sit for like 1 hour and 40 minutes and talk about shmups. But anyway, feel yourself at home, and I'm always ready to receive you guys and talk about, give my channel space for this. And I think the audience will like it too, because like it was pretty, I think, productive conversation, pretty productive chat. So thank you all, and well, I think we'll see you on the next episode whenever we manage to.
Yes, whatever.
2023.
Yes. Yeah.
1 year from now.
Exactly. 1 year from now, Junkie will be we'll finish the documentary. Me and Paulo will have Alessi Branch, and Mark will have DOG.
Mm.
And the conversation will be...
At least one of us will be happy.
Yeah.
The audience will not so much, for sure.
Yeah. One of the four is going to be happy somehow.
Yeah. Although I'll be happy with DOG as well, so...
Ah, me too. And the documentary. All right, guys. Thank you very much. And see you in the next podcast.
See you, everyone. Bye.